I'm Tairan. I'm a first year PhD student at the Robotics Institute at CMU, and I'm working on reinforcement learning and also how to combine reinforcement learning with traditional control theory to make robots behave and also go beyond human intelligence. What I'm thinking about the future of robotics, real intelligent robots will have the ability to safely navigate through confined spaces. Our robot can safely navigate through super confined spaces like offices, narrow corridors. It can go through a lot of both static and dynamic obstacles.
But the question we want to answer is, can we, you know, maintain this agility and simultaneously build a system that is safe, that people can trust? It is fully 100% autonomous and on board. All the computation, all the sensing, all the decision making are fully on board.
We add a depth camera in front of it, and this is directly connected to the mini PC on board. And this RENX JSON module that computes all the sensing and all the decision making. And then this mini PC will transfer all the control signals into the robot.
When you're trying to like make your robot safe, the intuitive way is to compromise your agility.
The current emphasis on the safety related work is how can you achieve higher agility under the same safety guarantee. But how can you make the robot both agile and safe? There's that internal tension between the two. This research is groundbreaking in the sense that we push the boundary of the agility and safety trade-off to a much higher level, which we simultaneously improve both on both axes.
There's a dual policy set up in our framework. The agile policy has a basic capability of collision avoidance, but the main contribution of ours into the agile policy is it can run so fast.
It is very fast. So the speed is up to 3.1 meters per second. It is really fast for laggy robot. It can adapt to, you know, rocky terrains, grassy terrains, and icy terrains. And fourth, I think very important, it is safe. So we do have safety guarantees in the sense that it can do collision avoidance, it can safely navigate cluttered environment.
So ABS has four components. First, we have two policies. One is agile policy that is for position tracking, which means navigation. And the other is recovery policy, which is for velocity tracking, basically trying to pull the robot back to a certain safe velocity when it is unsafe. And we have another two neural networks that works for prediction parts.
So because the robot has a very clear understanding of what will happen in the future, they can take actions before the future actually happens. And that actually resulted in the robot being much more fluent in the collision avoidance. They do not need to stop and think. They can think on the fly.
We achieve them together. That's the most challenging part, because there are a lot of non-trivial coupling between them. So how do you handle the trade-off between safety and agility and robustness? It is a very challenging topic.
Red light means the recovery mode is on, and then the green light means the agile policy is taking over. Right now the red policy is on because the default mode is red.
The computer vision basically maps the front view depth image into a low dimensional distance rate representation of the obstacle distance. It is asking whether I am safe at 50 hertz. We firstly chose laggy robot because it is challenging, it is hard. Because like we chose to go to the moon because it is hard, right? So we chose laggy robot because laggy robots can have more capability to traverse different terrains. The parts we trained in this paper is only for laggy robot, but our framework is general. Agility comes from a novel design of our framework, and that agility design could apply to other robots as well.
This project is my first project that I touched on to real hardwares. There are a lot of unexpected scenarios where the robot battery went out, or the camera breaks itself, or even the battery line of the robot leg breaks itself. I have to fix it up. I do have a lot of passions for hardware experiments, I would say, and that's also one of the biggest reasons I chose CMU to do my PhD, because I find my advisors also have the same kind of passion for hardware, and I really enjoy the process of pushing the limits of make the hardware perform better in the real world.